Train, Trains, Power, Money was released on PS1 in Japan at the tail end of 1995, and then it traveled to the rest of the world smack dab in the middle of 1996. It is an extended version of the fourth mainline title in a long-running train simulation series known as Eireisha Deiko, which translates to Let's Take the A-Train, or more simply, Take the A-Train. Let's go ahead and get the Dizzy region stuff out of the way. First, there was Eireisha Deiko 4 on the FM Towns and PC-98, released only in Japan in 1993. 1 year later, to coincide with the PlayStation console release, the game was ported to PS1 and called A4 Evolution. Then, in 1996, the game was re-released on PS1 with some additions in both Japan and Europe as A4 Evolution Global. This is the version that was ported to the US as A-Train. But A-Train on PS1 is not the same as A-Train on PC. That's actually Eireisha Deiko 3. Do you understand now? Good. Are you confused? Good.
Okay. I've been waiting for this moment for months, and it's finally here. I'm finally gonna get a heritage unit on camera. Yeah! All right, look at that, a 1953 E8. Woo-hoo! Oh yeah, listen to that bell. Yeah, listen to that bell. Oh, take a look at that. Oh my God! Woo! Listen to that horn! Oh my God! Oh, she's beautiful! She is beautiful! Yeah! All right! Oh my... Oh! Oh! Oh, oh no! It's a PL2 too! Oh! Oh! The SNC-52! Oh my God! Oh! We're gonna watch this!
What is the deal with trains? Why do people love them so much? Especially the kids! I watched both of my little brothers and my nephew obsess over these things. We had miniature tracks and tons of Thomas VHS tapes and toys. Actually, I'm kind of guilty of it too. I certainly felt a great sense of wonder when I used to crawl under the Christmas tree and play with the little electric train that went around in circles and shot out weird liquid smoke that had a very distinct smell, and if you know, you know. There is something so exciting to some people about these big metal things locked down to rails. It's like there's security in the tracks. They represent a fate that you can visualize and anticipate. This big hulking beast is guiding you along, making crazy sounds, and hell, slap a face on it and we got a deal. It was actually kind of funny the way that my research for this episode played out. I wanted to avoid two things. First and foremost, I don't want to do that YouTube intro thing that I find so insulting and boring. You know what I mean, like, this is a video about trains, so it would be like, "Guys, we all know about trains. Whether you're traveling to grandma's house or sipping coffee on the way to work, trains are a normal part of the American diet. But when did trains start? All aboard! Let's embark on the history of twains! But first, make sure to..." The other thing I didn't want to do is become too predictable. As much as I love researching things and talking about them, this particular topic started to feel kind of silly as I was going through the motions. I felt like a precocious little 8-year-old on his parents' computer.
"How many trains are there in the world?"
I don't want to dive into the historical aspect of subject matter every time just because of some arbitrary feeling of obligation, says the guy doing PS1 games alphabetically. But I've already failed at that because now we are just meandering, and like two tracks laid down beside each other, there are some parallels between this episode of BBG and the last one. We talk about metal inventions that hold people's interest and transition to Japan, where things are taken to a whole new level. Japan is known for its trains, whether it's a luxury escape or a quick trip to work with toast in your mouth. Okay, I'll stop. But really, it is a thing. There's the obvious association with salaryman culture, but also I feel like half the videos that pop up on my feed are people doing disassociative first-person train travel videos in Japan. and take into account some of the more standout aspects of Japan's train brain. There are at least two instances I can find of Japanese railway companies prostrating themselves publicly to apologize about being off schedule by like 20 seconds. There's a Hello Kitty train. Wait, hold on a second. Look at this guy. He hates this. There's an actual cat train, a Pokemon train, and a very real Thomas the Tank Engine. Oh, baby boys, we had the toys. And I remember hearing about a lot of events involving licensed music being played on trains, like stuff from Dragon Quest or Astro Boy. Speaking of which, there's Minoru Mukaiya. If you haven't heard his band, Cassiope, you need to definitely do that. But anyways, this guy is famous for creating the announcement and departure chimes in stations across the country. Coincidentally, he is also the producer for another long-running train simulator series of games called Train Simulator, which are used as professional train simulators for transit systems in Japan. Also, he did Sega Rally 2 Rearrange album OK Moving On. Let's get away from trains. We get it. This game is about trains. It's a Japanese game about trains. What I really want to talk about is the company behind this title and the rest of the series that it belongs to. This is a company that has long held passion and creativity at the forefront of its many projects. This is a company that has captured my heart during this research process. Previously, I knew who they were, but I really had no idea who they were. I have fallen head over heels in love with ArtDink. Founded in Tsukishima, Tokyo in 1986, ArtDink was initially put together by four longtime high school friends with backgrounds in the film industry, Japan's Ministry of Defense, and retail. The name ArtDink is based on all four members' names, as art just means art, but dink has to be split in half to make any sense. You've got D, as in the prefix of Greek origin for the number 2, and then there's N and K, which means N and K. So for that half of the name, the meaning is two N's and two K's in reference to the founders' names. Most of the background for Tatsuo Nagahama can be found online, including interviews and whatnot, but available information for the others dwindles. The original idea behind the company was to assemble central processing units for Motorola, but eventually they decided to make Bidja games, and oh boy did they. Anyways, years later, all of these people have moved on from ArtDink, but the name was kept. The very first ArtDink game happens to be the very first A-Train game. Eiresha Deiko was first released on the FM7, the Sharp X1, and the PC-88 in 1986. The game was somewhat rudimentary in presentation, but the concept overall clearly had potential. With the top-down display, the player could build tracks and depots to send their trains out on and through. Some of these are passenger trains, and some of them are more on the industrial side. You've got to manage your money, train schedules, railroad switches, and more. Having recently gone through the full series, I can look back at this one and say that by far the most consistent element that paints the identity of the A-Train series is the get there fast and take it slow state of being. These games can be stressful at first. Time moves faster than you would like it to. Certain things can only be done during the night or day. You're watching your funds deplete as you try to set up a perpetual income machine, and overall you're stressing out. But as soon as you get to any point of stability, things start to calm down, you watch the money come in, and you get to watch your little society thrive in the most meditative of ways. The A-Train series is like a sour warhead candy. It's extremely uncomfortable at first, but the sweet and succulent treat underneath serves as a reward. This game would eventually get ported to other computers like the PC-98 and MSX, but the version that I spent the most time with was the Famicom port from 1991. That is because this one got a fan translation. Thank you, you five people. Thank you very much. Eventually, I did enjoy playing this game. It was very satisfying to connect new trains to tracks, set their individual switches, watch them pick up cargo, and then in turn, watch your money grow. I never got as far as I wanted to get in the game, however, because I assumed that at some point this star train comes out and you essentially have to juggle the schedules of all of your trains and make sure that they don't crash into each other. You guys want to see the worst control scheme of all time? Look at this. It took me so long to get used to the controls in this one. I had to make this quick visual to help me memorize each diagonal direction. It doesn't really make sense because the Famicom controller had 8 directional inputs on it, so why do you have to hold A and press a direction to go diagonally? And to add to that, you can only build during the day, which is like 15 real life seconds, even when you set it to slow. Anyways, complaints aside, cool game, and we do not trash talk Art Dink's oldest child. Eresha Deiko 2 came out in 1988 on the PC-98 and Sharp X68000. This one actually did get ported to English-speaking countries for MS-DOS under the title Railroad Empire, not to be confused with Railway Empire, the much more modern train game. The PC-98 intro has some sick artwork, and the MS-DOS version is very old-timey America. In the same year of this game's initial release of 1988, there would be the first of an ongoing tradition of overwhelming expansion packs for the A-Train series in the form of Eresha Deiko 2 Shin Map. I can't find the cover for this one, so perhaps it was like a Takeru download or something. But there are tons and tons of expansions for other games in the series, and from here on out, I'm not going to mention them. Even though my stupid troglodyte brain forced me to painstakingly make this list of every single A-Train release in existence. Forget about it. It's not important. That's what I have to keep saying to myself, and it's exhausting. Eresha Deiko 3. 1990, PC-98, etc, etc. But this is important to mention. This one got Western PC releases in the form of A-Train. Do not confuse that with today's game. Don't make that mistake. They are different. In Europe, it was published by Ocean Software, and in the US, it was published by Maxis, which makes a lot of sense. You can kind of see how 1986 A-Train and 1988 A-Train 2 inspired some of 1989 SimCity, which inspired some of 1990 A-Train 3, which inspired some of 1993 SimCity 2000, and so on. Of course, there were other train simulation games that predated and coexisted with these. Southern Bell came out in 1985 on a myriad of personal computers, which is 1 year before the first Eresha. And there was a sequel to Southern Bell in 1987 called Evening Star. But both of these games seem to be more focused on the first-person train commandeering aspect, and less on the infrastructure creation and management by God from up above. Also, I just want to mention that there was a cancelled Squaresoft game called Amtrak in 1985. Anyways, Eresha 3 was the first entry that started identifying itself as just the letter A with Roman numerals, which would be continued for the next several titles, including today's game. Way later, in 1995, there was a Super Famicom port called A3SV, with the SV being short for Super Version. This one, unfortunately, has not been translated. By the way, and I mean this sincerely, do you all think the name of this series has anything to do with the famous song by Duke Ellington called Take the A-Train? And if you don't know it by the title, you definitely know it by the sound. You know, it's in like every period piece movie that takes place in the 1940s. These things are probably not connected, but you know, who knows? 1992 saw a Japan-only console release on the Sega Mega Drive called Eresha Deiko MD. Just like the Famicom release, this one got a fan translation, and it was done by some of the same people. This one borrowed elements from the first two games in the series, and this time, you know, you can just press the diagonal direction on the controller instead of feeling hurting things in your head. A4 came out in 1993 on FM Towns and PC-98. It would later see releases for a couple of Windows operating systems, but more importantly, here is where I feel the series really got its visual identity. There is something so beautiful to me about these buildings, on this land, in this weather. It genuinely held me captive for quite a bit of time. just staring at the screen. And believe me, I hate when people try to sound overdramatic about this stuff. That's not what I want to do, but I can't help how I feel. This is the Art Dink signature, a style that we will showcase a bit more in a second here, but yeah, this is what it's all about.
A4 Evolution.
As I mentioned, the PS1 port happened in 1994 to coincide with the console release. It was called A4 Evolution, and it is so close to being the same as Evolution Global, aka A-Train, on PS1. The additions came in the form of some music and new trains and stages and introduction of new cultural aesthetics that we will get into. But it is basically the same game, so I won't really discuss it right here. I will, however, mention that there was this really cool release commemorative set that came with a mouse, a mouse pad, and a memory card. And check out this foldable insert that came in the box featuring all of the trains in the game. It's gorgeous. In 1995, the previously mentioned Tatsuo Nagahama worked with French game developer François Lourdin of some company called IWP to make a game that used most of the assets from A4 called A4 Networks, The Supreme Art of Business. This was also released in the US as CEO, and it featured cutscenes starring a soap opera actress named Catherine Sparks and James Coburn, you know, like the dude from Magnificent Seven, The Great Escape, Charade, much more. In 1995, we land on today's game, A4 Evolution Global, aka A-Train. This would eventually fall under the PlayStation The Best series, which is basically Japan's version of Greatest or Platinum Hits, and it was at some point part of the Superlight 1500 series. That was a budget re-release program put together by Success, a game company we have spoken about before, and you can learn all about them right here. Anyways, I bought the 1996 NTSCU version, which, to my knowledge, was only available in the long box. It was published by Maxis, and that just feels right. How about this artwork by Steve Lyons? Some of you might be divided on it, but I like it. I've seen people compare this to that modern marketing style called Corporate Memphis, but I disagree. As you can see, this originally came with a booster pack for the SimCity card game. Mine did not have that. Mine was a library copy, which I think is kind of cool. Anyways, I bought this because of the mouse support. That's right, I got myself a PS1 mouse and mousepad. Specifically, I got a Tokimeki Memorial Forever With You mouse that originally was part of a box set. And I got the official A4 mousepad that came in the previously mentioned release commemorative set. Somebody peed on it. This game was followed by A5, which will be covered on the next video, followed by AZ, which had a weird PSP spin-off. A6 on PS2 actually did get an English port to PAL regions. There was Take the A-Train 2001, a mobile game called Take the A-Train I, A7, another mobile game called Take the A-Train EZ. There was Take the A-Train HX on Xbox 360, and it is apparently not good. You've got A-Train 8 and A-Train DS. A-Train 9 is insane because it is where Art Dink decided to stop and milk for like 11 years. Between 2010 and 2021, versions 1.0 through 5.0 were released, but if you include all of the additional packs and re-releases and expansion kits, the number of A-Train games comes out to be somewhere around 20. In that span, I will mention that there was the A-Train 9 derivative, A-Train EXP, because this one did get a US release by a certain company that likes to create FOMO. And there was A-Train EXP Plus, which did not get released here, but does have English as an option. We're nearing the end, I promise. A-Train 3D was released in English-speaking countries digitally, followed by 3D Neo and PC Classic. Take the A-Train for the First Time was a mobile game that had an updated version that was a partnership with the famous train line. In 2021, there was A-Train All Aboard Tourism on Nintendo Switch. This had a mobile port, and then two new versions released in a very Pokemon Red and Blue manner that each represented different train lines. This is currently where the A-Train series lies, I think. One thing that is really cool about this newest entry was the marketing that was done for it. They cut out a whole bunch of individual cityscape pieces and made a huge diorama. This is very Art Dink, if you ask me. Speaking of which, let's get the hell away from trains and just wallow in something moody for a minute. Art Dink, despite whatever truths regarding the nature of corporatism you may throw at me, is more than just a dang old business. I swear, Art Dink is a way of life. It is a series of colors and sounds that have been meticulously melded to make you melt. It says don't take life too seriously, but also don't take it for granted. Breathe it in and accept all of your natural reactions to beautiful things around you. Don't be embarrassed, baby. I feel that the most expressive example to use here is the hot air balloon sim Kaze no Nodum, or Nodum of Wind. Gameplay-wise, this is kind of like Pilot Wings with hot air balloons. But dear lord, where do we start? That gorgeous cover art was by the well-known artist with that signature style, Hiroshi Nagai. And the soundtrack. Oh, the soundtrack. It will get you very high. It was done by Ryuji Nishida and Yasuyuki Suzuki, not to be confused with the dude from the black metal band Abigail. I'd love to play it for you here, but I cannot, as it now gets hit with copyright strikes because a vinyl was recently put out. New age, house, surrealist pop, whatever you want to call it, it drips down your face and shoulders as you fly your balloon through the beautiful locations found within the game. You can design your own balloon with a very unique in-game editor, and I'm focusing on this because, to me, this represents everything that Art Dink is. Creative little surprises in every corner that don't even need to be there. Look at this menu within the options. Look at it. Look at this castle. Look at the name select screen. Wow. Now that your television and taste buds have been set to channel Art Dink Flavortown, you are prepared to consume the likes of Vampire, the Vampire Legend, in all of its strange glory. Compelling characters, RPG battle mechanics, you can turn into a wolf, and Ladeller that is ever present. Or how about Susume Kaizoku, Be Pirates? Along the way, you'll start to see some of the consistencies among the character portrait art, the proclivity for simulation mechanics, and the deep systems that can all be found in these games. There is Rome Wasn't Built in a Day, Tenka Gomen, and The Seed Warzone. Then we have Triangle Strategy, Wonder Boy, Asha in Monster World, Tale of the Sun, BCV Battle Construction Vehicles, No One Can Stop Mr. Domino, Zipang, Blitzstrass, One Piece Oceans of Dreams, Big Honor 3D Artificial Reality Professional Golf World, Turnabout, Arctic, a whole bunch of Gundam games, several Macross games, and more. We've also got the Conveni Special Monopolize 3 Worlds, which was a convenience store simulator that let you set up shops for the likes of cats and RPG characters. Just like Kaze no Nodum, the cover of this game was done by a well-known artist, and actually the other games in the Conveni series also featured really cool artwork, even though those weren't done by Art Dink. Anyways, those are just some of their one-offs. They also worked on the first two Legend of Heroes Trails of Cold Steel games, which I will never get to play because for some reason everyone got together and decided to make all four of the games in that series too expensive to even experience digitally, let alone grab a physical copy. I don't get it. Just specifically those four games are like that, and I kind of hate them without even playing them, even though everyone says they're really good. Similarly, Art Dink has a lot of 1-2 punch situations where they shifted into first and second gear with a new series and then kind of dropped off. They did How Many Robots and HR2, Golful Golf, aka Mr. Golf, and Moto Golful Golf, Sekigahara, and Kasen Sekigahara, High Seas Order, Trajectory of the Imperial Japanese Navy, and High Seas Order, Battle of the South Sea, Tokyo, 24th Ward, Tokyo, and Tokyo 2, The Forgotten Colony is Coming, Pioneer Immigrants Wanted. And there's Kikoshidan Panzer Division and Kikoshidan 2. There is Earth Defense Force and Far Side of the Moon Earth Defense Force 2. Neither of these have anything to do with the modern popular license that started as a D3 Simple Series game. Quick side note, Far Side of the Moon was famous for carrying a virus that infected people's computers. I really wish I could find a proper scan of the June 1st, 1990 issue of Login magazine, because apparently there was an apology issued in it. And you guys, we haven't even mentioned their other bread and butter franchises that tag along behind A-Train. How about the Atlas series, now known as Neo Atlas, with its at least six entries between 1991 and 2016? A map-making simulation game? Well, that is stupid, I say, before I play it and actually see that it is good. Or there's Art Dink's stab at Koshien games, with the Crown Is Yours series. There are at least eight of these titles released between the years of 1990 to 2004. Those are all cool, but the three franchises by Art Dink that I have developed the highest fondness for are Lunatic Dawn, Carnage Heart, and Aquanaut's Holiday. Lunatic Dawn is just one of those things that exists to make me wish I could easily read Japanese. There are several titles in the series that have these absolutely gorgeous diorama covers. I just want to dive in there and be a part of that setting and explore that little tiny room. It's so cool. The series started with its first entry in 1993 and continued on until the final release on PS2 in 2001, which I own. I mean, look at this. How could you not want to play it? Then there's Carnage Heart. Oh man, what a crazy concept. It's like Armored Core if instead of controlling your robots, you coded them. The coding is deep and initially confusing, but that is such a cool concept to me. I'm terrible at this game, but I'd love to get good at it. It came with a second disc that was comprised entirely of tutorial videos, and this is very necessary to play the game. Again, there's that beating Art Dink heart in the form of character portraits, out-of-left-field ideas, deep systems, and fantastic music. Listen to this song called Maniac Dance. Anyways, there were several versions of the first game released at different points between 1995 and 2013, but then the series spun off into Zeus Carnage Heart 2nd and Zeus 2 Carnage Heart. This took things to a much more narrative level, incorporating story arcs and immersive space station environments. The gameplay also got a bit more top-down strategy. In 1995, Art Dink released Aquanaut's Holiday. The name of the game could not be more literal. You play as a marine explorer who is feeling worn out from the monotony of normal life and day-to-day work. You are given the opportunity by some benevolent employer to casually rebuild a coral reef at your own pace. The game repeatedly reminds you to take it easy and enjoy the relaxing nature of your new placid job. To the sounds of haunting ambience, you get to explore the deep ocean and come across all different kinds of wildlife in the process. The more you explore, the more materials you gain to build your coral reef, and as you progress, a lot of the fish and creatures that you have met will come and hang around your creation. It's great, and the word therapeutic only begins to describe it. The first entry was the only one that got a Western release, and was reintroduced in Japan as Memories of Summer 1996 with some small changes. The second game came out in 1999, and then an entire console generation was skipped before the last title was dropped on the PS3 in the form of Aquanaut's Holiday: Hidden Memories. This one has Chinese and Korean versions that include English, which is great because PlayStation 3 is region-free, but yeah, this is what those versions can go for if you are lucky to even find them. All the games I've mentioned are associated with Art Dink either via development or publishing or both, but as I've said, I think there is definitely a signature strand that unites many of these experiences. Art and creativity are clearly on the forefront of this here identity. It's an endearing quality that brings me in and keeps me around long after the party is over. Unfortunately, it wasn't until after I had exhausted myself with research on the company that I was made aware of issue 9 of Scroll by Ray Barnholt, which is apparently an excellent look at Art Dink. You better believe I grabbed a print and it's on its way now. I'll leave a link for ya. Anyways, I think that the original president of the company, Tatsuo Nagahama, perfectly encapsulates the motivations behind Art Dink's guiding principles when he said this in an interview. I want you to be proud when you say, "I play games," even if you are a college student or a working adult. Be proud when you say you love games, that games are amazingly interesting, or that games have moved you. Okay, let's play A-Train. Well, at this point, I don't think there's a drop of vinegar left in my veins. I do not have the necessary amount of energy to properly gush over that intro. Please, play it at my funeral and keep it on repeat forever and always. In short, I love it. Anyways, select your control layout, language, and country of interest. That last one there is an addition to Evolution Global, and it makes very little difference other than determining which flavor certain structures will come in. For example, do you want a church or a temple? An Eiffel Tower or Statue of Liberty? You get the picture. Here we are in the land of trains. I like to come over here and set the speed to slow because, much like the previous entries, everything happens too fast at first. Unfortunately, the PS1 mouse really is not optimal for this game, because in that case, all of the controls are locked behind two buttons and stuff can get really confusing. Also, the manual mostly just gives instructions relegated to regular controller use, so after all of those purchases, I just ended up going with that. Anyways, this entire experience features somewhat of a learning curve, but once you get it, you get it. Different people will opt for different ways of explaining what is going on here, but I will put it simply by saying that there are essentially two forms of currency in this here A-Train game. First and most obvious is fresh cheddar cheese cash, but the other stuff you'll be mining is building materials represented by these little gray boxes. And I swear, Art Dink has tapped into that slot machine psychology by understanding and nailing down the addictive triggers here. Watching your train pick these materials up and bring them to other stations is pretty darn satisfying. Building materials are needed to build things, and where you choose to build buildings will have to be somewhere near these materials to pull from that stockpile. Of course, everything in this game costs money, but there's a neat and challenging balance that must be maintained between both monetary acquisitions. And this is directly reflected by the two types of trains you can purchase, which are freight trains and passenger trains. You can build stockyard squares around anything that might manufacture building materials, like power plants or docks for cargo ships. If you build a train station near these stockyard squares, your freight train will automatically load itself and carry on to the next station for a drop-off, provided that there's also a stockyard there. The previously mentioned balance comes into play when you consider that you've got to be near stocked stockyards to build anything that could in turn net you a profit, like a restaurant or a theme park, which acts as subsidiary sources of income alongside the money that your passenger trains are pulling in. If you're playing the game well, residential areas will start to pop up as you see profits increase. That, in a nutshell, is the entire point of this experience. Arcade-like, this is not. Essentially, the fun is to be had in setting up a perpetual machine and watching it either grow or just maintain itself for in-game years and years. As expected, most of your initial experience will be creating train tracks throughout this isometric land. I had a little trouble here and there because the inputs were too sensitive, and I usually found myself accidentally double-clicking and laying tracks in places that I didn't want them to be. So then, to remove the track, you press square to change the command and awkwardly go back over what you just did. And yeah, the game is definitely not perfect. The shoulder buttons are confusing. According to the button layout I chose in the beginning, at least one of them is supposed to let me scroll around on the map. But it doesn't work. Instead, all four shoulder buttons just seem to cycle through different terrain levels on the map. But even this is confusing, and sometimes doesn't really make sense. And it sucks that you can't just use a button in combination with the D-pad to scroll, because normally you can just move around on the map by bringing the mouse to the edge of the screen. But anytime you're engaged in a command, you can't do this. So you have to navigate all the way out of everything in order to just move a few feet over. Needless to say, this can get really annoying when you're trying to put down train tracks across a broad expanse. But overall, it's great. You can make bridges, tunnels, interconnected railways, and more. This also applies to roads because, in addition to trains, you can build a bus empire. As far as both vehicle types are concerned, take a gander at this beautiful selection available to you. So many options that I'm pretty sure are based on the real thing. And you guys know what the best part is? You can enter 3D mode and get the perspective of your train or bus. Jumpy Jehoshaphat, this is the greatest thing since 3D Lemmings. The amount of Lodeller here is too much for one little boy to eat. I'm dizzy. And it makes it so much cooler that the game has night and day cycles. It's magical both ways, but at night, the buildings glow in a way that speaks directly to my soul. I found myself trying to experience everything I could in 3D mode. Every new building I placed meant that I had to see it from the train's perspective. And tunnels? Oh baby! Bridges? Oh baby! And forest too! Look at that! There's a castle peeking just over the horizon. I was especially impressed with the number of structures you can build in this game. And almost every category has multiple options. You've got gyms, restaurants, skyscrapers, aquariums, rec centers, marinas, medium-sized buildings, monuments, spas, sports stadiums, theme parks, golf courses, airports, ski resorts, and so much more. And I love the implementation process of these things. For example, when purchasing a skyscraper, you can choose how tall it is, like this. Or when purchasing a train, you can choose how many cars it has, like this. The variety inspires strategy, and it's all very satisfying. I even love the way that you set the course for buses. You select the intersection and choose which way it will turn depending on the direction that it's traveling. You do this similarly for trains with connecting tracks. There are tons of doodle sheets for you to look at if you like to get that in depth. You can purchase holdings in different companies, you can sell off your subsidiaries, you can go to the bank and get a loan, and there are some surprisingly deep stats available for you to stick your nose in at any point. I love how when you try to go to the bank and buy stocks after sundown or on a holiday, you get the classic Art Dink character portraits telling you to get the heck out. The music here is fun and inspired. The first song you experience is definitely fitting for this game, but in particular, I like Uptown Women, aka song number 2. There are tons of different levels you can jump into at any point, though most of them are pre-developed in any given thematic way. And honestly, I prefer to build things from the ground up, though I understand that that isn't exactly the point of this game. I suppose the train mogul fantasy usually entails setting up shop in a pre-existing location and weaving your track through the environment in a way that complements it. But I don't know, I like to play it a certain way. We could get a lot more into the specifics of the mechanics of this game, but BBG isn't really meant to be a tutorial series, you know? I will say that the game actually does get addicting at one point. I found myself wanting to connect everything on this map, and I was feverishly setting up stockyard stations and whatnot. It's a really good game. The problem for me is that I suck at economy simulation. I always have. I used to love playing SimCity 2000, but honestly, I don't think I ever recall making a successful city. Usually, I just typed in Priscilla and made a bunch of natural disasters happen from the debug menu. Here in A-Train, I genuinely tried to make things work, several times actually. This recording is my third attempt. The other two I didn't even record because the first was on a CRT with the mouse and the other was on a PS3 on a modern TV. Anyways, as you can see by these numbers, I just couldn't get things going. I even put all of my freight trains on hold, and only employed passenger trains, buses, and I had a bunch of other businesses too. I just don't really get it. I imagine maybe you have to act accordingly with the daily passenger count for each vehicle, which I'm sure is represented by the size of the residential area. By that I mean buy small, do small numbers, grow residency, slowly buy large, and eventually do larger numbers. Not me, baby! I just took $20 million from the bank and purchased the largest and most expensive trains possible. I do wish I had recorded the other playthroughs because I just realized that I didn't capture any snow, which does happen in the game, and it sure is dang pretty. Still though, my biggest takeaway is the 3D mode. It really showcases that jagged PS1 look that I love so much. And it's done in a game that otherwise isn't even using those models during the main experience. It's just so cool, and I'm so happy to have experienced this. I really do plan on coming back and making a genuine effort to build a successful rail line. If any of you feel that you could make a decent stab at it and want to stream it, by all means, send me a link. I'd love to watch. Needless to say, this episode was much more heavy with Art Dink content than it was with A-Train, but I feel that I had the experience I was looking for, and I really like the game a lot. The next two episodes are the other two PS1 A-Train games, and they were never translated into English, so that will be fun. As always, thank you so much to the patrons of this channel. Your support is beyond inspiring. Be nice to people. Bye.